Welcome to Scorched Earth and a general reading for the sign of Libra, Sun, Moon or Ascendant for the month of May 2024. I hope you are well. We're using the Tarot of the Abyss for you today. This is the second time that I am recording your readings because I... audio issues. Anyway, before we begin, there's loads of stuff in the description box, so if you would like to go check it out, please do feel free. It's underneath the video right now. There are links to the extended to this video, 3 months overviews that I've done for each of the signs, my private community, the cards that I use in the reading. It's all down there in the description box, so please do feel free to knock yourself out and have a look and see what that is all about. So let's have a look down here. Tell me what's going on with Libra at the moment, please. So we have the Knight of Wands in your recent past. What about current energy, please, for Libra? Right. We have the Two of Cups and we have the Ten of Cups. And what's coming towards Libra for May, please? Thank you. We have the Tower. Do you know what's really interesting? That's exactly what came out before. Not exactly, actually, but the Tower coming towards you for May was what came out before. And the Devil also came out at the bottom of the deck. So some consistency across several weeks, which is interesting. Right, let's get some clarifiers and see what's going on here. Tell me about the Knight of Wands. What's the Knight of Wands here, please, for Libra? On. Ooh. There we go. So we have the Two of Cups again and we have the Hermit. Tell me about the Two of Cups and the Ten of Cups, please. Thank you. We have the King of Pentacles and we have the Six of Swords in reverse. And tell me about the Tower. Why is that here for Libra? We have the Eight of Wands and the Eight of Pentacles. Interesting. I actually like this for you. We've got the Three of Pentacles at the bottom of the deck. Right there. And I want to front up right from the beginning and say that in the last recording that I did for you for May, I went off on a bit of a side quest about a particular phrase that had been going around in my mind the morning of that that I recorded your video. And it was an Emily Dickinson quote from a poem. It's "Tell the truth but tell it slant." And that came up quite a lot in the last reading. And the reason how I tied it in was the fact that everything felt like it was a little bit confused, compromised, unclear at the moment. And what I felt was that you were sort of pushing towards some sort of crescendo, some sort of peak in the energies, but that one shouldn't try and understand too much of it just yet, because it was almost like the universe was drip feeding certain truths to you, which, like a domino set falling, had a kind of prerequisite that a certain truth be understood first before then you could move on to the next and the next and the next. And as things were at the moment, the bigger picture wasn't really that clear, and certainly any shifts or changes that might be coming up, and we're certainly seeing that, needed a foundation of certain understandings going on beforehand. Now, this is very much in the arena of relationships for you, and these don't have to be intimate sexual relationships. These can be friends, family, even co-workers and things like that. I mean, we've got a definite sense of the intimacy between you and another, but the extent to which potentially that there's a wider compromising of a certain stability beyond that. What do I mean by that? Well, we'll get into it and we'll see what's going on, because these sideways cards, as they've come up now, if you've watched my readings before, you know that I read cards sideways, and despite people taking me to task in the comments, I shall continue to do so. Because it's not actually that weird. We talk about, you know, energies crossing each other. And it's that crossing feeling that I'm picking up really strongly here for you today. Because everything feels like it's a little bit of a mess. Libra, without it being clear exactly how it's a mess, it's just that there's a lot of confusion here, and it's almost all emotional. We notice, aside from the Six of Swords, we don't have any Swords cards on the table really at all. We've got a lot of fire, we've got a lot of water, we've got a bit of earth there as well. Quite a bit of earth, actually. So, Devil being at the bottom of the deck means that we are talking about things that are deep-seated fears within us that possibly may relate to relationships generally, relationships specifically. But I think what is most important is you're probably not entirely sure. Well, you probably don't even know at this point that there's a fear there somewhere. I feel Moon Tarot here, just for a bit of additional stuff. But let's start over here. We've got the Knight of Wands. The Knight of Wands is Sagittarius energy. And although it gets rather a bad rap in relationships, it is a card of being entirely present. You know, the Knight of Wands is not generally a card that we'd like to see in relationship readings of any sort. I just want to point out that I've cut the deck, and we also have the Tower there. Because within the relationship dynamic, the Knight of Wands is thoughtless, reckless, impetuous, certainly not committed in any kind of meaningful way. But like I said, there are no cards in the tarot that are all good or all bad, and the Knight of Wands is no exception. So what we have is an ability to be present. And the thing that strikes me here about this is, because it's here with the Two of Cups and this Hermit card sideways, the Hermit's about going deep, really deep, and deep within oneself. The Knight of Wands, by contrast, generally is about keeping things relatively shallow and fun and, you know, at its worst, kind of hedonistic and all that sort of stuff, but certainly surface. So the dynamic here that we've got between these three cards, when they're talking about relationships that you have, is that there's probably one that it has been necessary for you to kind of dig a little deeper into than you're comfortable in doing. I'm looking at this Devil here on the table and thinking about what I said about a fear that you don't know that you have. But it feels to me like there's a relationship dynamic here that needs unpacking, that's going to show you much more about yourself than your mind currently thinks that it's comfortable in processing. Tell me about this Knight of Wands here. Oh, good Lord. Well, here we are again. Devil again. Seven of Cups. Well, absolutely. We've got Capricorn and, you know, certain toxic dynamics. We've got confusion. We've got the Two of Swords. Absolutely speaking to the fact that you don't see that you are, that there's something quite uncomfortable here. We've got the Nine of Wands and we've got the Eight of Pentacles. I mean, this is showing, fuck me, we've got the Hermit card at the bottom of the deck as well. I'm going to move these cards out of the way and just put them down here. I feel like the problem is that there is a relationship that should have been unpacked that hasn't been unpacked. For some reason, there's some sort of resistance in going deeper. And it might well be because there's a need for you to be cooperative. Your interests are best met, at least in terms of how you're seeing things at the moment, for you to maintain cooperation and collaboration with people. And to dig too deeply into a relationship will reveal all sorts of things that is going to shut down the possibility of that cooperation and collaboration, which for you as a Venus ruled sign is a very important thing. But the Nine of Wands indicates boundaries. The Eight of Pentacles indicates the fact that work is required for boundaries, and maybe you're not seeing where your boundaries are being overstepped. And this Devil is, I love this Devil, actually, he's just so sinister. But a really good representation of the kind of energy that would creep over a boundary. Now, this has all happened in your recent past, and as such, it's possible that it may not even at this point be necessarily making too much sense to you, because that Two of Swords there is telling us that this is somewhat shielded from view. In order to look at this relationship, it's going to show you things about yourself that are uncomfortable. Now, like I said, this does not have to be a spouse or a boyfriend or a girlfriend or anything like that. It could be a relationship with parents. It could be a relationship with children. I've seen a massive uptick recently in parents realizing that they have a child that is demonstrating, you know, really quite narcissistic tendencies. And I do think there's something that rather supports that at the moment within society. And it can feel counterintuitive to realize that one has to have boundaries against one's own children. And I think that that's actually true, whether or not you're having problems with a relationship with your children. But it can also be about friendships, and it can be about your wider social circles. It can be about your work environment and how you deal with people. What's very clear here, though, is that the revelation, when it comes out and it is trying to surface, I do feel that really strongly, because the devil is really doubling down on his energies here. And the Eight of Pentacles showing up here again, and we've got lots of eights, so this is about power and realizing where your power lies. They're all pushing you towards this idea of boundaries, where they don't exist and they should, where they're not as strong as they should be. And where your emotions about the situations have clouded everything. Again, we've got another five cards on the table here, and we've only got one Swords card there, and it is one of obfuscation. There's not a lot of thinking going on here, Libra. That's certainly not from a logical perspective. It seems like the emotions are doing all of the leading, but the emotions are clouded, they are unclear. And I do feel like what this is indicating is that there's going to be an escalation of pressure until the point where you put two things together that you have not seen. And I think everything that you've been experiencing up until this point is laying the foundation for a certain revelation of truth to come out. Like I said, tell the truth, but tell it slant. Like the universe is kind of drip feeding you things until it gets to a point of critical mass where you're like, actually, my thinking has to completely change now, the way that I'm seeing this situation. It's the balance, right? I'm always trying to keep things in balance, in equilibrium, in alignment. But there's a certain set of interests that have been best served by being cooperative. And that is not keeping the balance where it should be. It won't keep the balance where it should be for much longer, because some things once seen cannot be unseen. And I think that's where you're going, because this Two of Cups here and this Ten of Cups sideways is a relationship that you have that is close, or an experience of intimacy that you have that, or at least you're inputting into a situation that feels close, whether it's between you and a parent, you and a child, you and a sibling, you and your friends, you and your work colleagues. There's something here that you think is there that I think is not, because the wider expression of this, which is the Ten of Cups, sometimes known as the Happy Family card, is on its side. There's something here that is not coming through cleanly. Now, this could be, you know, aligning yourself with a certain person in the family that is causing, you know, which by effect is pushing you further away from the wider family, for example. I think it's reductive to come down on sides of things, feeling like you have to pick one person over another, or pick one group over another. But I am actually troubled by this Ten of Cups being on its side. I think one of the things that people don't really talk about with the Ten of Cups too often is the extent to which it can be an illusory energy. That there can be one kind of energy behind closed doors and another one on the outside of the building. And the juxtaposition of the internal, which is the Two of Cups, the very internal sense of what a relationship means to you versus the outward expression of it. And why it troubles you so much to admit that there is a discrepancy. It's almost like there are consequences that flow from this realization. Which feel to me, by necessity, are going to require you to pull away from a certain group of people or pull away from a certain person. Now, perhaps it's a recognition that there's some codependency going on. I mean, Two of Cups and the Devil, that would be very strong. And we've actually, you know, got it repeated across the readings. That would be a very strong sense of what's going on here. But like I said, the problem here is that there is a lot of emotion and there's not a lot of logic. There's not a lot of fact in amongst all of this. The suit of water is very fluid, and I feel like the wands and the pentacles here are to try and help create some sort of balance for you while your mind catches up. But I think it has to get a little more intense and a little more uncomfortable before that point is reached. Now we've got the King of Pentacles and the Six of Swords in reverse down here. Now the Six of Swords is always a return to something. There is a requirement here that you go back and examine the foundations of how you ended up here. Now it's interesting because I don't always feel like the King of Pentacles is a card that represents foundations. It's Taurus. We're often thinking about delayed gratification and what's going on in the future, right? Setting plans and, you know, going, that's where I'm headed and this is what I'm going to do here. But there is a feeling of needing to go back to look at the foundation of this relationship. How did things start and how have they ended up where they are here at the moment? Tell me about this King of Pentacles, right? We've got the Five of Cups and we've got the Queen of Cups. We've got more water energy going on. We've got Capricorn at the bottom of the deck again with the Queen of Pentacles. Well, I know this is a bit of a mess, but the Five of Cups is a card of grief. It's a card of loss. Interesting here, we've got somebody with their finger in their ears being told off by another character. And the Deviant Moon's got quite an interesting take on this, because usually the Five of Cups depicts just one character. And that one character is in a state of grief over what has been lost, right? It's focusing on the three cups that have been spilled. And there's a sense that there's a personal loss that has been experienced here, and there's some way that we're trying to find to deal with it. Well, actually, that's probably more about the point when you walk away from the cups. But it's looking at this and it's going, oh my God, it's gone. That's generally the way that we see the Five of Cups. Now here, we have two characters and we have one character that has kicked things over and does not appear to be particularly grief-stricken. There's something quite childish about this card and this situation here. Even to the, you know, having the fingers in the ears and whatnot. We've got this kind of mother-like creature in the background who's saying, you know, what are you doing? It's apportioning blame for something that might well have been an accident, except for, you know, the expression on this character's face here. It's probably not. Either way, doesn't seem to care too much. It's this character here that's lost something. It's this character here who's having an emotional reaction. This character doesn't care, doesn't want to know, isn't interested. Now, when you tie this all in with this King of Pentacles here, what we've got is a situation in the past. The foundation of this situation. Where too much was given. Too much love was given, too much understanding was given, too much forgiveness and compassion were given. That has put you in a situation where you now are feeling the loss of something. I feel like there's a huge issue with boundaries here, but there's a huge issue of accountability too. Now, whether in the past you've not held people to account in the way that you should have done, or whether you've not had the boundaries up that perhaps stopped this more sinister little character here getting anywhere near your cups, or whether you just gave too much in the spirit of understanding, and the consequence that is starting slowly to reveal itself is that the person who's lost out here is you. Deviant Moon is a very jarring deck. It's very visually jarring, and it's supposed to be. And even the so-called good cards have got a jarring aspect to them. There's a saying we have in the UK, I don't know if it's out there all over the world, that the road to hell is paved with good intentions. And I do feel like there are shades of that here. The Queen of Cups is representing the good intentions, and hell is the confusion of what is going on right here, right now. Now, have you aligned yourself to someone that you shouldn't have? Have you been too understanding and respectful of someone in the face of anything but that being reciprocated back to you? What is it that you've seen in this situation? What is it that you feel in this situation that has kept you going in a particular direction and now looks like it may compromise, it may be at the expense of something bigger that you're a part of? This is really intriguing, Libra. I mean, with all of those planets going through Aries, as we have had recently, we knew you were going to get a bit of a battering because that's just what happens. But there's an opportunity here to reclaim your power. I like the fact that the Eight of Wands is here. I mean, quite aside from the message that it brings, because we've got the Nine of Wands, which represents boundaries. So we've got a step being taken back, which is a really good thing when you're trying to work out where the boundaries are supposed to go, right? It's no point in standing, you know, too far this way and going, oh, I need to put them back here somewhere, right? They're in front of you because you've taken a step back. But the Eight of Wands is about an incoming communication. Now, when you've got eights together, as they are here, it's about power. It's about how you reclaim your power in a situation. And the Tower is a sudden and shocking a situation, which, you know, may or may not be sudden and shocking in the material. I've said before a number of times that my really the most profound tower moments that I've had have been while I've been doing the washing up or something like that. My brain has just put a couple of things together and I suddenly can't see the world in the way that I saw it before. But this discomfort And this emotional lack of clarity that is going on here feels like it's pushing towards some sort of big reveal for you. Whether or not you're doing the washing up while this happens is another question, but we had a card flip in the deck and it was the Hermit, and it actually flipped reversed. It was the right way up, but it flipped into the reverse. Oh, look at that, with the Ace of Swords. Interesting. I mean, what it's saying here is that that thing that you did not see, that thing that you did not know because you did not want to go in and look for it, is coming to the surface, and it's probably going to be pretty uncomfortable. Now, I don't want you to feel like this is negative, because although, you know, the Three of Swords isn't a particularly comfortable card, I don't think that there's any higher vibration than truth. And the Three of Swords is nothing if not a depiction of truth and emotions colliding so that a clear picture is finally formed. Now, it might have been that in the past you were quite comfortable in meandering along in this slightly fuzzy emotional state. The things that your mind screened off from you that were emotionally just a little bit too much to deal with, you know, conveniently compartmentalized somewhere. But we go from the obfuscation to the revelation here, and the world changes as a result. The world takes on an entirely different quality when we are forced to see things as they actually are. And I'm afraid to say, I do feel like you're being forced to see it as it actually is, because everything that's been happening in your recent past, we'll say maybe up to 6 weeks ago, right up to this morning before you started watching this video, there have been things that have been tweaking and aligning. Like I said, tell the truth but tell it slant. These things have been dripping in. And I think in May, what we've got is the achievement of critical mass, where certain things that were avoided or put out of the way can't be avoided any longer. The once seen, they cannot be unseen. Well, how about that? We have two cards. We have the Ten of Swords and we have the Death card. Now, those are pretty uncomfortable cards. I think the Three of Swords, the Nine of Swords and the Ten of Swords are probably the most uncomfortable cards in the tarot, the most challenging in the tarot. What we've got is an acceleration, a rocketing towards an absolute change in perspective, a change in circumstances, a change in one's perception of relationships and your family dynamic, your friendship dynamic, all sorts of things, by way of, you know, spectacularly uncomfortable revelations. But the acceleration and the rocketing towards is taking you to the end of something. We've got the Ten of Swords there, which is an end. You know, interesting, the big sword's coming out now, right? And then the Death card, which is transformation. You know, we talk about death and transformation when we're talking about Scorpio, when we're talking about death, but it's what we're really drawn to is the cyclical nature of this. You know, depending on where you are standing on the cycle is going to dictate whether this feels like an end or a beginning. But the fact that death is depicted as pregnant here, which is just genius, I love it. You know, while we've got this ship going down in the back of the card here, both of these representing endings, but also within that, giving us the opportunity. I hadn't even noticed that. Look at what's at the bottom of the card, the deck. We've got the Six of Swords in the upright this time, giving you the opportunity to really fundamentally connect with the truth of the situation. whether that's the truth of people around you or a truth about something that has been sitting within you that you have not wanted to see for a very long time, that allows you to put this down. Because it's very stressful to hold things within ourselves. Like we have somatic responses to these things. It's science is telling us this now. Excessive stress, excessive burden, excessive emotional turmoil will start before too long to have some sort of somatic expression within the body. Now, from the 10 of swords, we will go to the ace, and we've seen that already, and we've seen the hermit card there. It's an end, but it's a very necessary end that takes us to a new beginning. The death card, in order for us to transform. You know, a death card is about making space. And I think what needs to be made space in is your emotions. And the swords, as uncomfortable as they are what are helping you do that. Because where there has been fuzziness and a lack of clarity, the swords are going to bring it in and it's going to be very uncomfortable. But this is the shrieking crescendo that I was talking about, right? Once that is done and over, and we get to a point where we can work on what has come up, there we are released. There we are freed. Now, I think this is very, very important for where you go next, Libra. Well, it's interesting that this is an airship. Almost more appropriate than the boat that we see here. But, you know, it's crossing a body of water at the bottom here, right? We've got the emotions right there. But we've got the elevation of the swords, the elevation of the logic and rationality and information, because swords often talk about information too. But we've got burning building here. And we've got something that frankly isn't burning over there. So we've got the same interpretation of moving from, as we say, moving from choppy waters into calm. But you've got moving away from a burning building into something that is not on fire. And doing it by way of the workings of your mind, overseen by the moon, who's up here in the corner too. I think May is going to be quite challenging for you in a lot of ways, but if you can adopt the right attitude, which is that this is not happening to you, it is happening for you, and it is clearing out a lot of blockages that have been holding you in place. I think it will be much easier for you to get through the month. But I mean, with the devil at the bottom of the deck here, and over here too, where you're stuck and restricted is about to be revealed to you, and it's probably not going to be very comfortable, Libra. Right. I'm going to go over to the extended now. You can join me on Circle or you can join me on Vimeo, but I really want to kind of dig into this energy here. This could feel potentially quite negative, but like I said, it's all about attitude. If you've been feeling like you are at the end of your tether for a while, and most Libras that I know, most Libras that I've spoken to do seem to be fucking exhausted right now. Waiting for the situation to shift on its own, which I feel is what a lot of you have been trying to do, isn't going to work. There's a big shift here that needs to happen within you, and it's absolutely going to be related to boundaries. It's going to be related to a need for something to truly end properly, to shake you loose of where you are trapped. You just need to keep breathing through May. Because it feels like it's happening one way or another, and you can use this to empower yourself or you can use this to disempower yourself. I mean, both are true at the same time. So, like I said, I'm going to leave it there. You've got this, Libra. I have faith in you. Know that I love you all very, very much. And I'll see you soon.